Welcome back. You're watching African Perspective here on SABC News Channel 404. We're talking all things African, and the topic of discussion tonight will be looking at the extent of corruption on the continent and what we can do to rid ourselves of that. But we're also looking at the kind of leadership that presides over that. And speaking of leadership and some of those very thorny issues, Professor Arthur Mutambara has written a new book. He's the author of the book titled The Path to Power in Search for the Elusive Zimbabwe Dream. It's the second of three volumes in a series. He joins us now. Very good evening to you, Professor Mutambara, and thank you so much for speaking to us. As I said, it's a second in a series of three, and it talks about your experience as a leader in Zimbabwe. Tell us a little bit more about this particular one. Which era of your life are we looking at?
We're looking at the period from 2003 to 2009, and it's about the journey, the path to power. Not power in a self-serving manner or in a pejorative manner, but path to influence, path to making a difference, path to being a change maker. What is involved in building an organization? What is involved in calculating and building up new values, new systems that can deliver constitutionalism, that can deliver democracy, that can deliver shared economic prosperity? The path to influence, the path to the ability to make a change. Power, by definition, is the ability to change reality. Power, by definition, is the ability to change your circumstances or those of others. And so we're talking about power in terms of doing good, making a difference. And my journey and the journey of my colleagues in pursuit of the ability to be change makers.
And I want to talk about change makers because I know you also make commentary on the recent Zimbabwe elections. And in fact, you even suggest that they were rigged. Is that your belief?
Oh, certainly. The elections in Zimbabwe are not free and fair, but there are differences between 2008 and now. Number one, the opposition is not challenging parliament. ZANU-PF controls two-thirds majority in parliament. In our case, we, the opposition, controlled the majority and ZANU was in the minority. Secondly, when we said Mugabe was illegitimate after the runoff, we had the support of South Africa, the support of SADC, and the support of the AU. So the legitimacy of Mugabe after the runoff was questioned by South Africa, was questioned by SADC, was questioned by the AU. Unfortunately, for this situation, where there's a challenge to the legitimacy of Mnangagwa by the opposition, the South Africans have endorsed Mnangagwa. SADC has endorsed Mnangagwa. And the AU has endorsed Mnangagwa. So which makes it very difficult to operationalize the challenge to the legitimacy of Emmerson Mnangagwa.
You talk about legitimacy. What about the legitimacy of the opposition itself? Because you also speak about a people-backed coup, almost suggesting groundswell support for this incumbent.
There's enough blame to go around. Let me emphasize this. There's lack of statesmanship, there's lack of leadership, both in the government of Mnangagwa and also in the opposition. And I'll explain this. We need to see some degree of SWOT analysis being done by the opposition. What are the strengths? What are the weaknesses? What are the opportunities? What are the threats? I don't see that. We need to see the same being done by the government of Mnangagwa. What are the strengths? What are the weaknesses? What are the opportunities? What are the threats? I'll just consider on the weaknesses. For example, the government of Mnangagwa, major weakness. They've failed to rein in the economy. We have a major economic crisis in the country. Shortages of petrol, shortages of basic goods, currency crisis, and the general chaos in the economy of Zimbabwe. And also the lack of vision, lack of focus. Right now, some of them are talking about 2023, Mnangagwa for 2023. They are not serious. So they must address the elements of their weaknesses. The opposition, as I've indicated, yes, they're the victims. Yes, they're the ones on the receiving end of the rigging and the lack of fairness, but they must also understand that their case is weakened because they're not challenging the two-thirds majority in parliament. How do you claim the presidency of the country and surrender the two-thirds majority to ZANU-PF? If you become president, how do you run the country? without parliament. Secondly, as I have indicated, the opposition must understand that they have a harder case than we had in 2008. Why? Because they are on their own. South Africa has endorsed the Mnangagwa regime. SADC has endorsed the Mnangagwa regime. The AU has endorsed this regime, which means it is a tougher situation than what was obtaining to the 2008. So they must understand that. For example, when you say you want a national transitional authority, who's going to call the meeting? How does Mnangagwa call the meeting when you don't recognize him? How does he call? He calls as who? So you need South Africa, SADC, or the AU to call a meeting, which is harder because they, as institutions, have endorsed the election.
So let's juxtapose.
So what I'm emphasizing is that let's see more strategic thinking. You can't spend 5 years talking about a stolen election. What is the plan for the opposition for the next 5 years? Let us see that plan. Let us see that SWOT analysis, which is robust.
So reflect on the book. Talk about then what you did then as the GNU, especially from an economic front, which you also claim victory in terms of changing the lot of Zimbabweans. Mm.
So as I explained earlier on, our case was easier because the legitimacy was questioned all over the place. And hence there was negotiations facilitated by South Africa under the guise of SADC and the AU. So we're able to come together and have a GPA, Global Political Agreement, leading to the Government of National Unity. We're able to come up with reforms, in particular the new constitution. We're able to stabilize the economy. We're able to recover the economy. There were no shortages in the country. So we're able to work on the economy and work on the constitution.
All right. We're going to have to end it there. Thank you very much for your time. Professor Arthur Mutambara, author of that new book. It's called The Path to Power in Search of the Elusive Zimbabwe Dream. We'll be right back.